cast your ballot, hope for the best. This is where your vote rests. Oh, what we're gonna do.
Good evening. My name is Bahman Yazdanfar, and this is Voters Echo, a weekly program to bring different perspectives from different people, different cities, and different politicians, different elected officials or unelected officials, to bring the different angles from the issues that we, as a Canadians, as a Torontonian, as a taxpayers, facing day to day, for you to better understand what is our political environment is, or social environment for that matter, and how you can take part in the process. A couple of disclaimers. I am under payroll of no individual, no entity, no union, no political party. I am neither member or sympathizer of any federally registered political party. I am doing this on my own time, and I do not make any money out of this program. The airtime for this program, however, has been donated by Dr. James Sears as part of his credit to that channel's studio, which I appreciate him in advance. If any one of you wants to help me either in the form of the human resources or money-wise, there is a button on my website called www.voterseco.com that you can click in and find my address and drop me a line or two, and I will be more than happy to engage in a conversation with you and how you can help me to continue this program if you find it beneficial for you. Tonight, however, unlike all other programs so far we had, or I had with involvement of my guest, is dedicated to someone who donated and gave me a gift in the form of the song, which was introduced at this show on 19th of the October of this year, which was election night. So tonight's program is not about politics, it's mainly about the life and the procedure of an artist in this city or in this nation and how they proceed in their life with their art and artistic value. So without further ado, I want to introduce you to Karen Lee Wilde. Thank you, Karen, and thank you for two things, accepting my invitation and being here, and secondly, for giving me the gift that I enjoy every night. I look at it and the rhythm is going through my ring.
Well, thank you, Bauman, and I want to thank you for the opportunity to come out here and play. And as you know, it is November the 11th, and this is a day to remember our veterans that gave their lives, you know, to keep our country free. And I'd like to attempt to do.
So a is it new song?
No, it's a song that was written in the 40s, and maybe I'll play a bit of it first, and then tell
you
about the history.
If it is the Remembrance Day, why don't you go for the full play?
Okay, this is called "They All Call It Canada." Side by side, and step by step, our fathers were marching along. They were building a road to the future with a spade and a smile and a song. Out of the wilderness and out of the sand grew the land we live today. Though the job to be done had barely begun, there is one thing I'm proud to say. My country is my cathedral. The northern lights my dome. They all call it Canada, but I call it home. The mountains, the lakes and valleys, they all call it kind. Atlantic to the Pacific, from the pole of the USA, where one united brotherhood and united we shall stay. The peoples across the border and far beyond the foam, they all call it Canada, but I call it home. Anyways, it's a song you only do once a year.
Have a seat, please, so they can adjust your camera. Then we get to the core of the matter. First of all, thank you. Very nice. Well, you want to disconnect that?
That's okay. I'll just turn it right down.
Now, I know you, a couple of years now, more or less. Mm-hmm. And can you, because the audience do not know you probably, or can you tell to our viewers a little bit about yourself? How did you start with the music? How long have you been in this gig, and so on? So they very briefly, about 5-6 minutes, they have a mini biography kind of the.
Okay, let's see. I started singing, I guess when I was about 13, and I 12 or 13, and my parents, through a friend, Jean Clark, introduced me to Art Snyder, who owned a big recording company called Sound Canada. And he was a vocal coach and helped me build up a repertoire. By the time I was about 13 or 14, he had a little trio that played at Pier 1 Fisherman's Wharf, and I started performing there. And by that time, I knew what I wanted to do. And as soon as I could get out of school, I joined the circus road of music.
Oh, okay. So because I want to reiterate that I did when I spoke to you a year ago when I had a different show, and I spoke to you about writing some sort of the song, and then we stopped that show because the election was finished at the. And by then, certain things was changing. And this year, when I mentioned that I am having different name for the show, and you started to write for that that lyrics, I did not quite honestly expect that kind of the song. I thought maybe, again, I am not a musical person. I don't. I am completely ignorant in the music. Or any form of art. I am not a very cultivated man. However, when I looked at the structure of the content with the limited information you had from me, I want to ask you how the process of a songwriter goes about that. How did you, I'm just using that as an example. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying because of that, but I'm saying in probably you use the same process to write a song. How this process goes?
Well, you know, everyone has a gift. And, you know, we're all gifted and are meant to do certain things. And songwriting is just one of those things that came to me very naturally at a young age. And so, you know, I was in a car accident a couple years ago, and that's actually one of the first songs I've been able to write since then. And
The Walter's Echo song?
Yes.
Oh, I'm really, really honored.
Well, my brain got shook up a bit, and besides my body, and so at least you got a comfortable seat here because my tailbone got.
And you did a hell of a job.
Well, thank you. And you know, they say half of it's perspiration, the other one part is inspiration. So just in talking to you and understanding a bit of how your show was about, and plus, you know, the title of your song, it just kind of happened that way, and
no. What I mean is, when you look at, let's say, the only thing I gave you, I said, hey, I have a show. It is about the issue of the bringing different perspective of the different politicians, different people, about the politics. The name is Voters Echo. And all of a sudden, I see some sort of the mini story in that song about the person that cast his or her vote, but does not know about the result of that, because you say the vote, you rest.
Right.
And then you bring the perspective of the, I can say cynical or a little bit suspicious view that you use the Oscar Wilde quotation on that.
Right.
And then you bring another element which dealt with the elements that being used in a form of the divide and conquer, as well as those who use religion as a form of the combat. And at the end, you bring a unity and unifying people. I did not tell you none of those things.
No.
I want to be very clear. I just told you it is the Voters Echo. I want a little bit of the rhythmic song in front of it. And then I, in my surprise, I see the whole story of what's happening in every election or every in every contest of the political power between the individuals and the actual power. So you just sat there. Did you go through the way that I explained it to you? Because I think more kind of the logical way. Or did you just with your feeling just brought your own past experience and put it in the song?
Well, being that I'm, you know, we're talking about the elections and building up to that, I basically put it in a sense where, you know, after, you know, we cast our ballot, we are sometimes a little helpless after that.
Yes. So it was your personal experience or a personal understanding of where people how to go through it.
Yes, exactly. To that extent, and also, you know, the different aspects of, as you say, divide and conquer, and you know, I studied Roots of Modern Canada at York University. So I knew a little bit of background of the different political styles.
So are you political?
I like to say that I like to be a voice for the voiceless.
Okay, do you participate in the political process? You vote.
Actually, this year I didn't vote, and for two reasons. I was doing your show, and I had just gotten back from out of town.
Oh yes, I remember that you said that you came back. So I am responsible for you not to be going.
Well,
to
no, and I also well, I was going to rush down, and then okay. When I saw the polls, where the polls were, I just figured.
But
it was
generally
futile.
Speaking, do you vote?
Yes,
okay.
Normally.
So you vote. Do you take part in the political party or anything like that?
Not normally. No.
Okay.
No.
So you are just using all of your senses as a citizen to write that song.
Right.
Okay. So that was clear. You are a very talented woman, believe it or not. Very, well, very talented.
Thank you.
And it's not just because it's written to me or given to me as a gift, but I showed the lyrics to a couple of other people. Even to a English literature expert, and she said simply, "I wish I had this kind of the talent to come up with this kind of things." Put
well,
it this way.
I wanted to make it not too difficult of a song, so people could, you know, could catch on fast.
As I said. Now, coming back again to you, now that we know that you are using your intuition and your gift and all of that. Can we play a clip from the time that she played in 1999 for CTTV, I think it was?
Yeah, Breakfast Television.
Breakfast Television. Can we play one, and then I ask you a question regarding that?
The ice to your yourself. Carrie Wilde and Wild Child, they'll be a part of the 6th Annual Beaches Christmas Blues Festival this Saturday. They're with us now. Please welcome them.
Put me on the right track. Don't you ever look back. My vengeance is mine, says the Lord. Life is just too short.
That was great. And when was 1999?
Yeah, I believe so. That's
okay. Why? It seems to me that you were in a kind of on top of your game at that time, especially not having the technology of internet and all of the. I mean, there was internet, but it was not as expansive as it is right now. What happened after that? If you feel comfortable about talking about that, of course.
Well,
I don't want to get to the emotional aspect of that. I just want to see what's happened to the life of an artist.
Well, many things happened after that. You know, sometimes you go through band member changes. That song I actually wrote for the Church of God when I was part of the Church of God back about maybe quite a few years prior to that, and so I've always been also on a spiritual quest, and I'm trying to think of what year I was also studying at York. I was taking a course, a film course, I believe, back then. So what happened? To say I was on my top of my game when I wouldn't really, you know. Well,
for any artist in Canada to get to a gig on Breakfast TV and being given the opportunity to sing two songs back to back, it's not easy task for all of the other artists, is it?
Well, it was to help promote some of the local artists, and which was really great, you know. I don't even know if they're still doing that. I'm not really sure. They do have some music, but. I actually, like, our drummer, I think, got some work with Ann Romer.
Oh, okay. And did you receive any offer after that show?
Well, we were playing a lot of gigs. You know, we were playing, you know, quite a few gigs on the weekends and stuff like that. And, it was a fun time. And we were... We're anxious to keep on playing, but the market in Canada is quite strange. You know, we don't have the same kind of system as the U.S. to, you know, to just vault people into, you know, a continuous success, unless, you know, you've got a major record company behind you or something like that.
Have you ever considered to go to U.S.?
I did.
Nashville or anything like that?
Well, actually, I did play in Nashville, but not a major club there. And in my younger years, in 1979, I was with a band called Terry D and Showdown, and we played like the Pepper Tree Lounge in Tampa Bay, the Pocono Mountains, and actually, I think the Pocono Mountains was with a band called Skylark. I'm getting them mixed up, but we played some really nice clubs, and I was offered with a Court of Flags. They had like a 10-piece house band, And I was, as I say, I was very young. I was underage. But so I had a really nice offer when I was playing in Florida. But I'd been on the road quite a bit, and I was having my own ideas for my own shows, and I was getting
most
a bit homesick.
Have that. Most artists are rather independent kind of thinkers.
I think so. Because you have to, you know, take in a lot and then try to let your mind relax and analyze that when you're writing, you know, from all different directions, trying to see things from a bird's eye view sometimes.
Well, you had even a kind of the MTV show. I remember when I was watching that a couple of months ago, with a white coat or something like that, you were walking.
Oh, yes,
do
yes,
you
yes.
remember that?
Yes, yes, yes.
So you went beyond that to make a kind of the MTV style kind of the song.
Yeah, I was taking a film class at York University, and I was musically partnered with a person named Ross Stewart. And
Rod Stewart?
No, Ross.
Ross Stewart, okay.
Yes, and we had co-written that song, I'll Miss You, that's the name of the song, and I told him that I wanted, you know, during my film course, you know, I wanted to do a video, and he acted also in the video, and it was a lot of fun to make.
Well, he was playing the boyfriend or something like that.
Yeah.
I don't remember exactly.
Yeah, we were involved at that time.
So it was the real story.
Yes. Kind of. Yes, almost too close.
Okay.
But so it was, we also had some great musicians, Chris. Can't think of his name. Great sax player, who backed us up in that, and he had a little studio, so we were able to record the song there. And then, during my film study, I applied it to the song to my course, and he was Ross was an additional feature in that song, and so it was. It's nice to be able to.
And after that, I believe that was about 2000, year 2000 or something. Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned earlier that you had a couple of years ago, you had an accident, you didn't write any song till the Voters Echo came along. Now, between 2000 and 2013 or 2012 that you had the unfortunate accident, what were you doing music-wise?
Well, I'd say I was always writing, and that's a long time.
No. Generally speaking, did you continuously stick to the music, or because of the circumstances of life, you have to let it drop then go? And it is like a life of many Canadians. It is, unfortunately.
Yeah, the end of 2005, I got diagnosed with Hodgkin's lymphoma.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. I did not even know that.
Yeah, so I went through a year of chemo till, the 2006 to 2007 in between there. And it takes a long time for your body to recuperate after that, too.
I bet.
But I actually started...
Are you clear now?
Knock on wood, so far, so good.
Touch on wood, good, I'm glad.
I started back into music after that, and actually I was doing a lot of blues music, and I took up my high school instrument, which is trumpet, and I started playing a lot of blues trumpet and stuff like that.
And where do you play?
We were just playing some local gigs, and some of the local places, California's, I was playing, what's one on the Danforth there, the Black Swan. Actually, that was...
White Swan.
Well, and the White Swan.
Oh, yes.
That place burned down.
Yeah.
But the Black Swan, I actually had a gig back in, doing a Monday night open mic jam. But that was actually before before the cancer, actually, I'm thinking now. But we did do some, continue to do other gigs at the Black Swan. And there was some other clubs, a place called Pockets on Young Street. And
So you were on and off, were active music-wise, writing, playing, composing, and yes, performing, of course. During 2000 and 2013, except that 2005, 2006, which you were a little bit involved with, not a little bit, heavily involved with your health issues. Now, during this 10 years span, do you remember how many songs have you wrote? Or
Well, I probably have at least over, 400,
400?
Yes, but I've been writing since I was,
have you performed all 400?
At different times, yes. I mean,
at different time, of course, not at one time.
But I mean, at different times.
You need 7 days a week, 24/7, to run around 400. No, I mean, sometimes singers or songwriters usually write songs, but they don't really take the chance somehow to perform some of those.
I try to perform. I'm more practical, I guess, and so I definitely, try to perform as much as I can, my music. And as a writer, you write different idioms. Like in the church, I wrote a lot of, kind of gospel songs.
Are you a religious person?
Yes, I am.
I'm not talking. It's the difference between spirituality and religious. I am not talking. I gather that you're a spiritual, but I don't know if you're religious.
I think I am. Yeah, like at this time of my life, and different things that have happened to me, I kind of step back and try to see if there's a reason to use my music. As I say, one is my children's book, White Wings of Hope, that is a charity foundation, and I dreamt the book and when I was about three, and I wrote the song White Wings I think it was 82. I recorded it in 84 at a studio called Walrus Studios, and Russ Harwood. He was the engineer, and he did a great job. They might have that up there. White Wings.
White Wings. Yeah. I'm just looking at the book itself.
Yeah, take a look at that. Yeah, that's it. Deals. The book is deals with a child and how she sees the world and what's going on. It deals with international with things that she sees of between starving children and war-torn areas, and also domestic, because her mother is divorced and is a new person, a new man, and White Wings is the fictional character that she
is like a comfort.
That she dreams about. That's to help come to help the world,
and that's a.
And I did bring you a T-shirt. This is our T-shirt
for the White Wing.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you very much.
So that's for you.
Oh, thank you. The next time I come to one of your jam, probably I would have it on.
So I spent a lot of time working on the charity for a while too, and I did approach different people like the United Way, the Red Cross, and I was.
How receptive they were they?
Well, the song I had recorded, as you say, back then, and so the sound quality, as you see, it's an older style sound quality where it's using tape, not digital.
That can be always updated.
Right. But I, being a perfectionist, I always, wanted it to be produced a little better. So we were working on that, and the Red Cross, as I say, we were going to work together, but I have a symbol of the Red Cross in the book, and they wanted me to take that out and change it. So we kind of hit a wall.
Symbol of the Red Cross in the book?
Yeah, because it
you
deals did, with
you
people
didn't
that
do it
are
by
helping.
Intention, did you?
Yes, I did, because I was showing different people that are out helping the world, and And
so what was their objection?
And this is what I mean, that they feel that they own the rights to the cross.
Oh, the copyright.
So I was still thinking either to modify it or, but I legally I didn't think they really owned it. I don't mention the Red Cross, but I do show that where the people, the Red Cross is helping.
They should be appreciative of that. Can we play a little bit of that White Wings, Chris, if you have it on the queue? That was great. That was great. It's a little bit of the goosebump, even though I am not a musical person, but because of my past experience being in the war, when you talk about when a small child goes through the that agonizing moment. When you came here, you sang a song that you said is older. Is there any reason you just particularly chose that song?
Which the first song I just sang? Well, one, because you know it is Remembrance Day, and today is the day to remember our vets. And
Do you have anyone in the family that has been a vet?
Yes, my grandfather on my mom's side fought in World War II, and like many of the people that returned, you know, nobody returns back normal, I guess, from war.
World War II or World War I?
World War II.
Okay.
Yeah. So actually, I don't know if he fought in World War II, but and I almost gonna bring his jacket, but I couldn't. Anyways, long story. But and I also found it quite interesting that the composer of this song was an alien, enemy alien.
His alien? You mean alien or the?
Well, back then, alien would mean that not from our country, right?
Yeah.
And his name was Fritz.
From Germany, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay.
Fritz Grundland.
Because Germany called the Allies alien.
Exactly. So. But he was a forced immigrated to Canada. He went to London, England, and in 1940 he was. A lot of people rounded up, and he came. They were forced immigrated.
Oh, he was a civil person.
Yes.
You know? He was not like in the army of.
Right.
Okay.
So he ended up in Farnham, Quebec, and he ended up adopting this country. And he wrote this song, you know.
Although English was his not native language.
No, so yeah. It was quite interesting.
I printed a copy of one of the many, many poems that when I was much younger.
So he changed it.
Said in English, probably I have to give it to you to make a song out of it.
So he changed his name to Freddy Grant. And it was published, I think, in 1954 as Freddy Grant. So
he wrote it. Did he sing it too, or he wrote it for someone?
I'm not sure. I'm not.
Do
really
you
sure.
know who was the original singer of that?
Or? I believe he did sing it, but
okay.
And.
Right now, I know that you are during last two and a half years that I know you, you are in a process of back and forth with your back injury and because of the. Accident and all. Let me put this question this way. Do you have any imminent plan in the music for yourself? It is one part of the question. And the second part is, after you answer that, think about it. What would be the ideal for you if you had all amenities available to you?
Well, that's kind of a twofold question. I mean, one, to try to use my White Wings Foundation to help in some charitable way, because there's a lot of big organizations. I think I'm going to focus on a one-to-one.
How do you want to go about it? Do you want to create in some sort of a charity organization, or you want to be joined to one of the existing ones?
Well, White Wings is a charitable organization. I did register it as a charity.
You have charitable founder. Number on that?
Yes, I do.
When was established?
Oh God, at least I think 2003.
So in last 12 years was not active.
No, a lot because I didn't know what direction I was going in, and then a lot of medical reasons, and then my other aspiration is basically a couple of musical plays that I've been working on, and I had registered a company called Swing My Blues, and had intentions to start the company up, and. About 4 years ago, I fell off the back of a stairs where I was living, and then a year after that, I was in a car accident. So that kind of
and it's very strange. In the last 2 years, you never mentioned about these two companies to me. So, and you know, my profession is business consulting.
Well, I'll be talking to you after, if that's sure.
we were talking about music most of the time, or at least you were talking. I was listening mainly, but you never mentioned. So that is the two. So what is the direction of that music company that you created? What do you want to do with it?
It's basically I want to put on put on a musical. I have a musical that I've been writing. It's called Swing My Blues, and it's kind of a jazz and blues musical.
No, is it kind of the solo thing, or do you want to gather all of the other musicians?
There's dancers, there's actors. It's a
so
big
you,
show.
So you want to have kind of the show to be packaged, like a package show, to be presented for people who want to have it either in their events or in the ceremonies and all of that.
Yes.
That is the plan.
Yeah, it's to be in like a live theater.
Oh, okay. Yeah. But it is a package that what you're selling is not just one person, it's just the whole package of the dancers, singers, writers, musicians, and players. And about the White Wings, what was your aspiration, what you want to do with it?
Well, when I come to a crossroads in my life, and sometimes even the accident, and things like that, it tells, I usually, when I seek my higher power, things like White Wings always comes back to keep moving on with that. And hopefully to be able to, help, people through this.
Any particular group of people that you are aiming to help, or is it just in general?
Well, at this point, I wouldn't say one particular group, but I'm focusing more on individuals. There's a lady that has a form of muscular dystrophy. It's called Marie Tooth Shara.
So many of them, yeah. Even I don't know.
And she's a friend of ours, and I'd like to try to make awareness for different people that aren't part of a large group. They don't have a common.
So at this stage, you don't have, the idea about white, White Wings, you don't have any particular focus. For instance, if we have Breast Cancer Society, if we have blood, mm-hmm. they are focusing on one particular subject matter. You do
right.
not have at this moment any particular demography, so to speak.
Well, White Wings did, after I went through cancer, we did do a couple of concerts and try to raise money through the White Wings Foundation for that, which we did, which wasn't a phenomenal amount, but...
No, I understand that. What I'm saying from perspective of organization, you do not have yet any particular direction that you want to go.
Not at this particular time.
And would your aspiration is, then it comes to second part of question, if amenities were available to you, if the situation was favorable in every aspect, you had the right people, right money, right location, what where you want to be, let's say, in 5 years?
I definitely like to see the foundation, doing well, and hopefully, helping as many people as possible, and if I could produce my musical, that would be great. I guess that'd be enough on my plate for now.
No, I understand that. I just wanted to see, because most people, they have always the charitable side to them, that they want to do something either for mm-hmm. their society, for themselves. Doesn't matter. I personally don't believe in the altruism, but I believe in, even if someone wants to help another person, even that sense of self-satisfaction by itself could be very indulge the person, that's fine. But they have that part, and they have the part that it is their skill, their talent, in your case is music. When I was looking at your music again a couple of months ago, I saw one music that, do you have the list of some of that?
Can
I see?
Oh, I didn't think so.
There was I don't remember the name. Mm-hmm. As I say, as you know, my program is unscripted, unrehearsed, uncensored. There was one song that I saw in your YouTube channel. It was more rhythmic. It was more, it was not, it has some sort of the...
Maybe C'est la vie?
No, it's not C'est la vie. C'est la vie, I have heard that. There was another one. Do you have the list of the songs in front of you?
That's the one at York University. Is that the video, or was it just a song?
No, it was just a song. I cannot see it.
Walk in the Fire.
C'est la vie, I'll miss you, White Wings, Right Track.
Right Track? Which one?
Yeah, we that was the way what he played.
No,
that.
No. What was the one that you said? The fire
Walk
line.
Walk in the Fire.
Yes. Can you can you play that?
That was written around the same time.
It has a more kind of the.
Yeah, that's.
Yes.
I know you kind of got to stay away. Passion turned to fire, I'm engulfed in your flames. You mean no harm, it's only a game. There were no promises, so there's no one to blame. I've seen what you've done, the scars that you leave. You wash your hands and walk away while they bleed. Never returning, for there's never no need. Did you get what you want when you got what you pleased? Cause when you walk in the fire and you lose all control, walk in the fire, who's gonna save your soul? When you walk in the fire and the lights have you blind, walk in the fire, you burn sometime.
Yes, that is the one.
That the one you're thinking of?
Yeah, the reason I liked that one because it gave me some sort of the sense of urgency to motivate people to do something.
Right,
the rhythm of the not the lyric necessarily, but the rhythm of the song.
Right. Yeah, that was written. That was back in the 80s.
And it's different than the rest of your songs. The rest of your songs are more melody-wise, more hippie style kind of.
Well, that's got a little bit of Latin because between. I did a year at Humber College in music. After 10 years of being on the road, I went back to school, did my education backwards, and then I got accepted to York University. And during that time, during the summer, I went through Mexico. So and I was hearing a lot of Latin grooves.
Yeah, I've been around.
So that was, and I was in touch through the different churches and stuff like that, and. And so that was kind of an interesting journey.
So this Line of Fire was because of that experience that you had during that time, or it was written for the different purpose?
Definitely being down there and the Latin music, hearing all that Latin music did influence the style, you know, to have. You know, I was definitely hearing like Latin rhythms and that. But I really love Latin.
You never figured, you never expected I bring that one up.
No, I was not intending to play that one at all.
Yeah.
So yeah.
No.
I'm actually amazed that I.
Because I, as a person. Hey, wait, I am a music virgin kind of thing. I don't have any knowledge of music or singing. What I know is what goes through my under my skin, stimulates my tingling senses. Certain music does that to me, and this was one of those music that when I was, as I said, 2-3 months ago, when I was looking at, we were talking about Wouters Echo, I just looked at it and, oh, that is interesting. That is different. Now, have you written anything recent? You said you haven't written anything since last 2 years except the Wouters Echo. Did you start to, was Wouters Echo a start of the...
Yeah, it kind of was. It kind of maybe started to unblock a bit and, some of the scrambledness and what was going on with my brain, you might say. And also, the songs that I wrote, just prior to the accident, the last couple of years, I've been working on those ones.
Yeah.
And
do you have any recent one? I know that for last 2 years was the Wouters Echo.
Yeah.
But beyond that, do you know any one of them that we haven't heard, or at least I haven't heard?
I'm sure there's quite a few.
Oh, yes, 400 songs a day. I never spent that much time.
There's two that I have in mind right away. One that I wrote for my friend's wedding in New Hampshire, and this is called Tiny Hand, and it was dedicated to them. And
Let's see,
it was written quite before that, actually. I think, but I'll play a bit of it for you. I don't know where this road may lead. All I know is long as you're with me, there ain't a mountain that we couldn't climb, or an ocean that we won't see. So if come and tell me all your dreams. Together we'll make everyone come true. Honey, you can count on me. So put your tiny hand inside my pocket. Put your heart upon my pillow. And let me love you. Says we're crazy, well then let them say so, babe, and bring your sweet love home to me. Ooh, yeah. And bring your sweet, or bring home that sweet love, bring in on home to me.
Bravo, bravo.
There's a couple more verses, but I didn't want to do the whole song here because I know time's so short.
How are we doing on time? About 10, 15 minutes? Oh, yeah. Having said that, you wrote all of these songs. I want to twist a little bit our the direction of our discussion about the life of the artist in Toronto or in Canada in general, because you deal with a lot of other artists too. I mean, players, other singers, and so on. I noticed I know one of the guys that it was in the original video that we showed. JJ was the.
Johnny Lightning.
I noticed he was playing. Although you haven't much changed, but he has.
I don't know. I've changed. When you go through cancer, right after, they put you on some steroids. So I was feeling really good, and then, once you get off the steroids and stuff like that, and menopause,
it's like a withdrawal.
Puts you right into menopause right away. So that's another, thing that messes you up. Yeah. And also this last, 3 years of dealing with other injuries, the weight gain, that's the first thing I noticed.
You are a kind of accident prone.
No, that's...
I'm just joking.
That was like my first... car accident, I think, over 10, 15 years. Good. I only had one minor one besides that. So,
Dealing with when you meet these guys and girls when you perform, I'm pretty sure either before the gig starts or after the gig ended, sometimes you talk to each other. Mm-hmm. And based on my experience, I noticed they are. In general, many Canadians are in a struggling mood, but artists, specifically artists, What do you see the life of artists as is right now? Is there any, first of all, what are the challenges? Is there any way the governments or the institution can help?
Yes and no. I mean, you know, when video came out, there was a big transition there, you know, and that's when the struggles kind of began. But now it's actually, now there are opportunities through the media and internet that...
You mean social media?
Yeah, I mean, there's so much out there now. It's that you don't that it is as much as it is helpful. There's just so much out there at the same time, so it is hard to get through. But I think if it's your life work, you know, it's kind of like Whitney Houston, you know, it's words, you know. At least I live as I believe. That this is what I am, what I do, and if I'm successful, that's great. If not, well, that's, you know, it's just the way it goes.
It's like anything else.
Yeah.
My question mainly was focused on the let's say red tapes that sometimes I was talking to publisher of the Your World News the other day, Leroy St.Germaine, you know him very
right.
well. He was telling me the red tapes that they put for the even street artists.
Oh,
they want to put a small, let's say, a small amplifier in during the daytime, which is not, they have to go through the process, or if they don't get the permission, they get fined.
To me, the fact that the government will actually make people pay to get a license to play on the streets in cold subways. I know a girl in her 60s played saxophone, Sadie, you know, and God bless her. But because she is an artist, and that was she is, and she can't be anything else as much as I can't be anything else. It's who I am, which is also a title of another song, but that was written on piano, and I don't have a piano with me. So back in the 80s, you know, when they changed the liquor law license from 1 o'clock closing the bars to 2 o'clock, they didn't adjust the subways for that time. And even now, that's the downfall. Our subway system, now
at 1:30 is
and that's ridiculous, because you're leaving people stranded or shoved on a bus where you can't get off near your, maybe not near where you live, like a bunch of sardines with a bunch of drunken people, which is no fun if you're a lady. And it's very unsafe. The subways need to be running to a minimum at 3 o'clock in the morning. You know, just to accommodate that you're a cosmopolitan city.
Other policies.
And
that
the fact that they're not doing that, it makes me question, why aren't they? And, you know, what is holding them back? So that to me is very upsetting. Sure, they might start off early, 8 o'clock earlier, but really, if you really want to promote your music scene and promote people, you need the subways going to 3 o'clock in the morning where you can accommodate people so they can get home and not have to worry about these other, you know, other modes of and getting home a little safer, you know. I think it's very important.
And how what is the connection between the artist and this issue?
Well, the fact too is that if it's easier for people and not expensive, you know, if you have to pay for your cab or something like that,
they can go to this restaurant, bars.
Exactly. More people would stay out and see entertainment, and that way it would increase. I don't believe that artists should be on the street. I mean, it's something that someone wants to volunteer, that's different, you know, if that's, you know. But most true artists want to be in a club where they can, their hands aren't freezing and they can play, you know, or too hot in the summer, where it's conducive so that they can actually show their art to the best to their ability.
So let's say even though if they have to, stay on the street because of circumstances, what do you think the motivation of the city is to just focus on the issue of the small amplifier or something? Why is it that important for them? Especially when they have their own construction worker making noise, unpleasant noise all the day.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, anybody can make a complaint if they don't like it. But I think the fact that they've decided, you know, policies come out of City Hall, like before you even get a chance to blink. And everything is kind of the reverse. They throw things at you first, and then it's up to you, the citizen, to try to fight against it. So that seems to be their policy and how it works there. So, which
and most people really give up on the process.
Yeah, I mean, people find a way to get around it. You know, people that are willing to play on the street just so they can still do their art. I think that Toronto should have more clubs in different places and should try to bring back. Like back when I was playing, like the Westbury, the Castlemore, and these nice places that, you know, I could have got a loan for a house back then. I was respectable. You know, our costumes, our whole well-being is based on that persona, you know,
and
feeling good
become,
about it.
Become completely
and to put yourself to the point where you feel like you're a beggar on the street begging for money, you know, makes me also wonder why they would, first of all, try to make you people licensed to do that. It's just what they should be focusing on is finding places for artists where they can work.
Is there any association?
And maybe
or
they
any
would pay taxes.
Well, yeah, of course. but is there any association or any kind of the
musicians union used to be quite prevalent back then, and you know you had different ratings of clubs. You had A club, B club, C club, depending on you know which we were playing, and they basically would say what the scale would be for that room. A lot of good bands also, you know, usually got paid above scale if you had a following or if you had the type of a show that attracted people to come out and see you. So then came a point where all of a sudden the musicians union were asking for more money for dues, you know, to help pay pension plans for people in the symphony and things like that. And a lot of the bar bands, because, you know, some of the people may not, you know, make their living out of it, or, you know, I would say, I don't want to say, you know, certain people have a calling and other people can do, you know, be more flexible.
Is that union still active?
I believe, sure, it is, but it seems to be more active, you know, with dealing with plays and symphonies.
Oh, okay.
There's not as much of a market in the clubs because back then.
So it is the bottom line was not profitable for them.
Right.
Am I off the shot? Because I am moving a lot back and forth, I know that. Please excuse me and thank you, Chris. How are we doing on time? Over 3 minutes. So first of all, I want to thank you for coming, and I want, if it's possible for with Chris, I ask you to end after my saying goodbye, end the program with a song of your choice.
That's hard.
Well, let me just thank you for being with us today, and I know this program was a little bit different than the other programs, but I hope that you enjoyed as much as I did. Although the message never changed, please remember to take part in your electoral process, which is part of the only thing left of democracy as we know it. Vote, participate, help your candidates, help your MPs, write to everybody, get them to be accountable, and more importantly, roll up your sleeve and become a candidate in the next election when it comes knocking on your door. So we finish this program with the last song from Karen.
That's the hardest part. But I'm going to pick a song that that I sing quite often in the clubs, and the chorus is kind of like a sing along. But you may not know the words. But it's my stepfather was French, and one of his sayings was "C'est la vie."
Okay.
So I wrote this song in his honor.
Is good for the end of the program.
Yeah. he passed away. So this is called C'est la vie. When your troubles seem too much and you're feeling out of touch, c'est la vie, c'est la vie, c'est la vie. When you feel you can't go on, find a friend and sing along, c'est la vie, c'est la vie, c'est la vie. C'est la vie, c'est la vie. When the world's too much for me, raise your glass, have a cheer, c'est la vie. When you're feeling sad and blue and you don't know what to do, c'est la vie, c'est la vie, c'est la vie. I once had a special friend I've known since I was three. You might say he was just like a dad to me. And there was dreams of passing by, I'd never see him cry. And he'd say these simple words to me, c'est la vie, c'est la vie. When the world's too much for me, raise your glass, have a cheer, c'est la vie. When you feel you can't go on, find a friend and sing along, c'est la vie, c'est la vie, c'est la vie. C'est la vie, c'est la vie, c'est la vie.
Great. Thank you and good night.